Amen. Aren't you glad he saves this morning? 435. Let's go there today. 435 all together. Let's stand as we sing. Since Jesus came into my heart, what a wonderful change in my life has been wrought on that first. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. In my soul, for which long I had sought, since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea pillars roll. Since Jesus came into my heart. I have ceased from my wandering and going astray since Jesus came into my heart. And my sins, which were many, are all washed away since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea.
Singing, good to see you in church this morning. And of course, if you've never know what that's all about, having Christ in your heart, we pray you'll come to understand what that's all about this morning. But good to see you in church today. Thanks for making the effort to come out. Let's bow in prayer to start our service, shall we? Father, thank you for another Lord's Day you've blessed us with, and thank you, God, for the beautiful sunshine this morning. We're bowing now before you to thank you, Lord, for a great salvation that you provided for us through Jesus Christ. And Lord, I'm asking today that you would help us to exalt him and to lift him up. And as Christ is lifted up this morning, may you draw all of us closer to him. And those who need to know him as their Savior, may they come to trust him as their Savior today. But strengthen all of us and help us because we gathered together here this morning. May you be pleased with the service. May you use in each one of our hearts and lives. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Number 57, if you would turn with me, please. Number 57, at Calvary, years I spent in vanity and pride. Let's sing that first together. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. No. Not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to men. Oh, the mighty call that God did spend at and grace was free. Pardon there would multiply to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary.
All right. Now, a few announcements for us. Listen carefully, if you would. We have our scheduled today. There's no Christian growth class this evening. We'll resume that again right after our turkey dinner Sunday. And so we'll resume that again on November 20th. All right. And but we will have evening service 6:30 this evening. And I want to invite you back for the evening service tonight. And right after the service tonight, all of those who help in the children's church, I need to have a brief meeting with you in the conference room right after the service tonight. Give you your schedules for the next couple months and go over a couple things with you. And so those people who work in there, you know who you are, meet me in the conference room after the service this evening. Remember, this coming Saturday is our makeup date for the hayride and bonfire at the Mannings. And the sign-up sheet, the original one, is down on the table. If you were not on that and you want to get on it, put your name on there. If you were on there and now maybe this weekend doesn't work for you, then you can cross your name off and help us, just help us to know what, and maybe if you forgot what you signed up to bring, then you could look and refresh your memory, all right? And but you can remember what you're supposed to bring. But everybody, if you can, whoever can bring chairs, bring a chair with you, okay? Don't have enough stumps to sit on, so you gotta bring your own chair, okay? And we'll have a great time Saturday evening out there at the Mannings. That's a great time. 5 to 8 p.m., the bus is gonna leave here at 4:15 sharp, okay? So if you're pulling in the parking lot at 4:15, you can wave to them as they go past you out the driveway, okay? So if you're going to ride the bus, don't get here at 4:15. Get here by 4 o'clock so you can get on the bus, and they'll be ready to pull out right at 4:15 sharp, okay? And we'll have a great time there Saturday evening. Now, next Sunday, the 30th at 5:45, we'll have our organizational meeting for our dinner day, our turkey dinner Sunday. That's coming up November 13th. Going to be here very, very soon. And we have to organize and be prepared for that. And we will do that next Sunday evening. So don't miss out on that. Have some special incentives this year that we haven't had before. And so I'll unveil those for you next Sunday night as well. All right. And I think that's all I have right now. So let's take a moment and welcome our guests that are with us today. If you're here today and you're not a member at Bible Baptist Church, or maybe you brought a guest with you today, we'd love to meet you and find out who you are and where you're from. Would you just put your hand in the air for us and say, I'm visiting today. Got one right over here. All right. You want to introduce yourselves? Go ahead. And got some right in front of you. Tell us who you are and where you're from. Great, great. And you have your boys with you? Oh, okay. Great, great, great. And who's the other fella? Your cousin. Okay, great, great. Thanks for being here this morning. Glad you're here. Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay, Nick. Great. Good to have you this morning. Thank you for being here. That's good. All right. Anybody else today? Missed. All right. If you'll take just a moment and you'll fill out the welcome card there, we will have a record of your visit with us this morning. In a little bit, we have the offering. If you'll just drop that card in the plate, we'd appreciate you doing that, and we'll have a record of your visit. And then you keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. We're glad you're here this morning. Let's give these folks a warm welcome, shall we?
Was alone to give all.
285, 285. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Let's sing that together. 285 on that first. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. As we sing that last together, children, you can go out to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church. Let's sing that last. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, I'm laid. Singing this morning. Let's go to 241, if you would. 241, marvelous grace of our loving Lord. Grace greater than our sin. When you find that, if you'd stand with me. Let's sing that first all together. Marvelous grace of our loving Lord. Grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on one another, make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. blood will pardon and cleanse within grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. That fourth verse of 241 said, marvelous, infinite, matchless grace freely bestowed on all who believe. Let's sing that last together. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. We'll sing that a cappella. On that last together, did you find your seats? Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see his face, will you this moment his grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than.
Singing, you may be seated. Sounds wonderful. And the ushers are coming. We're ready to receive our offering now this morning. Give as God has blessed and prospered you throughout the week. And if you have your welcome card that you filled out, feel free to put that in the plate as it goes by, if you would. And we'll pray and ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. We'll have Brother Abrams lead us in our prayer.
Let us pray. Lord, our Heavenly Father, we come before your throne boldly. To say that we come in your presence in a glad tiding, Lord, and a thankful spirit for all that you've done for us and all that you're going to do, Lord. And we ask that you bless this meeting together today, that if people are not saved, may come to know the Savior before it's everlasting too late. And Lord, give our pastor the wisdom and the knowledge that he needs to put himself aside, and let us give the message that God would have us to hear. And Lord, give us this offering, and may you bless it, and bless each gift and each giver. In Jesus' name, amen.
Take your Bible this morning for our scripture reading, if you would, to 1 Chronicles chapter 29. 1 Chronicles chapter 29, if you would, please. And then I'd like you to pick up Proverbs 29. So 1 Chronicles 29, and then the book of Proverbs in chapter 29. Read 1 Chronicles 29 first, And then we'll turn over and read one verse out of Proverbs 29. So 1 Chronicles 29, we're going to read the first 9 verses, and we'll read them responsively, begin together on verse 1, then I'll read 2, we'll alternate like that till we end together on verse 9, and then we'll turn over to Proverbs 29 and read one verse there together. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word, and let's begin together on verse 1 of 1 Chronicles chapter 29. Ready? Furthermore, David the king said unto all the congregation, Solomon my son, whom alone God hath chosen, is yet young and tender, and the work is great. For the palace is not for man, but for the Lord God. Now I have prepared with all my might for the house of my God, the gold for things to be made of gold, and the silver for things of silver, and the brass for things of brass, and the iron for things of iron, and the wood for things of wood, onyx stones and stones to be set, glistering stones, and of diverse colors, and all manner of precious stones, and marble stones in abundance. Moreover, because I have set my affection to the house of my God, I have my own proper good of gold and silver, which I have given to the house of my God, over and above all that I have prepared for the holy house. Even 3,000 talents of gold, the gold of Ophir, and 7,000 talents of refined silver, to overlay the walls of the houses withal. The gold for the things of gold, and silver for things of silver, and for all manner of work to be made by the hands of artificers. And who then is willing to consecrate his service this day unto the Lord? Then the chief of the fathers, and princes of the tribes of Israel, and the captains of thousands and of hundreds, and the rulers of the king's work, offered willingly, and gave for the service of the house of God of gold 5,000 talents and 10,000 drams, and of silver 10,000 talents, and of brass 18,000 talents, and 100,000 talents of iron. And they with whom precious stones were found gave them to the treasure of the house of the Lord by the hand of Jehiel the Gershonite. Then the people rejoiced for that they offered willingly, because with perfect heart they offered willingly to the Lord. And David the king also rejoiced with great joy. And then Proverbs 29, one verse we'll read together, verse number 18. Proverbs 29 and verse number 18. And let's read that together. Ready? Where there is no vision, the people perish, but he that keepeth the law, happy is he. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer now. We thank you, Lord, for another Lord's Day that you've given to us. And we thank you today for the Bible. We're so grateful, Lord, that we have your word in our hands today. And Lord, I pray that your word would be quick, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. And that, Lord, it would accomplish this morning in each of our lives what you desire for it to accomplish. That each of us would knowingly and consciously yield ourselves to the authority of your word today. And Lord, I pray that you would give us all ears to hear what the Spirit would say to its church this morning. Now, Father, bless the special. Make our hearts good soil that the word of God can fall into, and we'll thank you for it. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be a king of a vast domain, nor be held and sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
Father in heaven, I bow before you in prayer now, and Lord, we thank you for the wonderful salvation we have in Jesus Christ. And Lord, I desire that Christ would be seen this morning, even as we look at this passage from the Old Testament. But Lord, I pray that you'll help me as I bring the truth this morning and help each individual as they listen. And I'm asking you, Lord, here in advance that your will would be done in every heart and life. I do not know the needs of every individual, but I'm confident you do. I cannot meet the needs of every individual, but I'm confident you can. And so, Lord, I'm asking you by your Holy Spirit to move up and down the aisles and in and out of the rows. Stop at every occupied seat and minister to people today as only you can. And Lord, I'll thank you for what you'll do, and I'll thank you in advance for the help you'll give us. And I ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Dean, you might give me a little bit more. I don't know why I'm a little raspy today, but didn't have anything to yell about last night. Just cry, you know. But Proverbs 29, verse 18 says, where there is no vision, the people perish. A fifth grade Sunday school class was asked to go home and count the stars in the sky as a part of their next Sunday school lesson. When they came back the following week, the teacher asked how many stars they counted. Some said 100, some said thousands, some said millions. Finally, the teacher asked one little boy who hadn't said anything, well, how many stars did you count? He said, three. I said, three? How can you see only three? He said, I guess we have a small backyard. And you know, when it comes to vision, when it comes to really believing something, a lot of people have a small backyard. They don't tend to see very much. Helen Keller was asked if there's anything worse than being born blind, and she said, yes, being born with sight, but having no vision. Being born with sight, but having no vision. Someone said vision provides the push through our problems. Vision provides the energy for the effort. Without vision, passion dissipates, agendas surface, production falls and people scatter. The automobile genius Henry Ford once came up with a revolutionary new idea for an engine, a new kind of engine. And he was eager to get that idea into production. He had some of his men draw up plans and present them to the engineers. As the engineers studied the drawings, one by one they came to the same conclusion. The visionary boss just didn't know much about the fundamental principles of engineering. And he'd have to be told gently that his dream was impossible. When told, Henry Ford said, "Produce it anyway." They said, "But it's impossible." He said, "Go ahead, stay on the job until you succeed. I don't care how much time is required." Well, for 6 months, they struggled with drawing after drawing, design after design, nothing. Another 6 months, still nothing. And at the end of the year, Ford checked with his engineers, and once again, they told him that what he wanted was impossible. Ford told them to keep going. And they did. And what they eventually discovered was how to build a V8 engine in the automobile. Huh, we don't see many of those anymore, do we? But you know, the Bible is, not only is history filled with people with vision, the Bible's filled with people with vision. The people that could see things, not with the natural eye, but to be able to see things as God would have them see things. The ability to see not as man sees, but as God sees. And you know, when you get vision, when you get the vision as God sees things, I'll guarantee you something, it won't be comfortable for you. It'll always be a little bit uncomfortable when you see what God desires as opposed to what you will be able to see with your own eyes. Think about, in other words, whenever you get a vision of what God can do in you and through you, it's going to be uncomfortable. You're going to realize, if I do that, I'm going to leave my comfort zone. I kind of like it here. I'm comfortable. I like where I am. But think about some of the biblical people of the Bible here that if they didn't want to move out of their comfort zone. Think about Noah. Think about it. What if Noah just would have said, "Well, Lord, I'm really not into boats. I really don't do that kind of thing. All right, I never really have been much of a builder, God. Carpentry? Build a boat?" What about Moses? If he had said, "God, I really don't get along with people very well. Lead a group of people? Not me." How about David saying, "God, I really don't do giants." Or, "Hey, lead a kingdom? I'm just a shepherd. I'd rather just stay with the sheep. They don't talk back to me. They don't give me any problems." What about Mary, mother of Christ? What if she'd have said, "You know, I really don't like children. I wasn't planning on having any babies." Every one of those cases, they had to get out of their comfort zone. They had to, in order to fulfill God's vision for their life, they had to get out of where they were comfortable in what they were doing. You know, the biggest obstacle to your vision and my vision is ourselves. In fact, the biggest person you have a problem with, and we're doing spiritual warfare on Wednesday night and teaching about our battle with the devil, but the truth of the matter is, the person you have the most problem with is you. It's the person you look at in the mirror every day. That's who you have the biggest problem with. In fact, someone said this, and I wrote it down. If we could kick the person responsible for our doubts, most of us couldn't sit down for a week. I like that. And so, God help us to have a vision for what He could do in us and through us. Now, in 1 Chronicles 29, if your Bibles are open there, what you have here is a vision of David to build a house for God. Now, it's interesting. David got this in his heart that he had a nice house to dwell in and other people had a house to dwell in, but God only had a tent to dwell in. And he said, God ought to have a house. And it's very interesting, and I won't have time to look at it right now, but he went to Nathan the prophet and told Nathan what he wanted to do. And you know what Nathan said? "Great idea, man. Go for it." David thought, "Man, great." And so he makes plans to do it. And he's going to build a house for God. And by the way, Nathan was the prophet. Remember, in those days, you didn't have any writings from God. You heard from God through the prophet. And so the prophet gave his approval, it must be good. And so he started making the plans until Nathan went home that night, and the word of the Lord came to Nathan, the prophet. You know what he said? David will not build the house. He's been a man of war. He shed a lot of blood. I'm going to have his son build the house. So then Nathanael had to come back, or Nathan had to come back to David and say, put a stop on that, David. God said, you're not going to build it. But David said, well, he didn't say I couldn't prepare for it. He didn't say I couldn't get it ready. He couldn't say I could get everything. I'm going to get all the material and all the things prepared for it that I can, so then my son can build it. David had a tremendous vision of doing something for God. And it wasn't just as he got older. The great thing is, he didn't lose his vision when he got older. The fight that you find, and if you're over 40 years old in this room, and certainly if you're over 50 years of age in this room, you find that it's a battle sometimes to keep a vision alive. You just kind of, just let me have life like it is. Don't rock the boat. And yet you don't really want to put the wire out and go across Niagara Falls. But somebody in their 20s or 30s will. They'll say, let's do it, man. Let's go. And so you have to work at that vision. And David, hey, he had the vision as a youngster to take on the giant. He took on Goliath when soldiers and more experienced than he and men that were bigger than he wanted nothing to do with him. But David would do it because he had a great vision. But he still has this vision as an older man wanting to do something for God. Now, I want to look at David and his vision today, and I'm going to talk to you about vision and the ingredients that David had in his vision and the ingredients that we need to have a vision. If you don't have a vision, the Bible says, the people perish. They perish. You'll die without a vision. That's why many oftentimes, how many remember a coach in football named Bear Bryant? Remember him? Alabama, famous Alabama football coach for years. And did you know when he retired from coaching football, I don't think it was 2 months later he was dead. Why? That was his passion. That was his vision. And now what do you do? He can't finish his life out putting on Bermuda shorts and playing shuffleboard. He's lost what he was living for. You got to have a passion. You got to have a vision for what God has for you to do. Let's look at David here in 1 Chronicles 29. Notice, first of all, the first ingredient of a vision is preparation. Preparation. Notice what he says in verse number 2. Now I have, what's the fourth word? Prepared. What is it, church? Prepared with all my might for the house of my God. And he talks about the gold, for the things of gold and silver and etc. And then he talks about in verse number 3, I have set my affection to the house of my God. I have my own proper good of gold and silver, which I have given to the house of my God over and above all that I have prepared for the holy house. Preparation. And he says, notice he prepared in verse 1 with all his might. David wasn't in this half-heartedly. David wasn't in this apologetically. He wasn't in this apathetically. But zealously. He was in it with all his heart. Notice in verse 3, I've set my affection to the house of my God. He said, there's going to be no doubt in anybody's mind through my preparation where my heart is, where my zeal is, where my affection is. You know, I've seen rooms the size of our conference room downstairs filled with guns, various rifles and high-powered rifles and different handguns and different ways. I mean, filled wall-to-wall with guns, a tremendous gun collection. I've been in warehouses that have been filled with automobiles, collecting. Many people who collect automobiles. I've seen doll collections displayed in beautiful lighted cases that people were bragging that a couple particular ones, not the whole collection, just a couple particular ones were worth $250,000 for a doll. I've seen coin collections that I'm sure have taken a lifetime to accumulate and have been worth a great amount of money. And when you see those type things, you walk away and you say, my, you must love guns. Or you must love dolls. Or you must love coins. Or you must love cars. But listen, folks, I want people to be able to look at my life, and you ought to want people to look at your life and say, my, you must love God. Where are the people that say, hey, I want to love God. I want to love the work of God. I want to love the people of God. I want to love the things of God. I want to set my affection to the work of God. That's where my heart is. You give because you love God. Hopefully you're here this morning because you love God. You're going to love. Listen, you give because you love the Son of God. You're here because you love the Word of God. You're just in love with the things of God. He prepared affectionately. He prepared sacrificially. Notice what he said in verse number 3 again. He said, I have of my own proper good of gold and silver, which I have given to the house of my God. David said, I'm not just giving out of the king's treasury, out of the government coffers, so to speak. He's saying, I'm giving of my own money. I'm giving of my own proper good. I'm giving sacrificially for the house of God. The church was raising money for a new building, and people were coming to the front. They had offering plates up front, and people were walking up and placing their gifts in the offering plate. And the pastor noticed one couple who came up and got to the front, and the woman was struggling a little bit, and she finally got her wedding ring off and put her wedding ring in the offering plate. Went back to their seat, and when the pastor got the word later that night that the need for the money they were raising for the building had been met, he got on the telephone Monday morning and called the couple to tell the woman that he wanted to return her wedding ring, that the need had been met. She said, well, pastor, I appreciate that, but she said, I didn't give it to you. I gave it to the Lord. Anytime something great for God is done, sacrifice has been made. Talked about that with our missionaries. Anytime you're a missionary and you go to a foreign field, if you've experienced success, it's because somebody has sacrificed before you got there. There is no success without sacrifice. You must have sacrifice. So David sacrificed. He gave sacrificially. Hey, the Bible you have today, the Bible we hold in our hands, do you realize? I just saw a video yesterday of the men and women that gave their lives so we could have a Bible. William Tyndale. You ever heard of William Tyndale? Was the first, one of the first ones to ever translate a Bible into English. Burned at the stake in 1536. For translating the Bible into English. The Bible you're holding today, I hope you know that people paid for that with their life so we could enjoy it today. We have the success of the Bible, and we have success of being able to carry and have God's words because someone else sacrificed so we could have it. Salvation, the greatest gift of all. And we enjoy eternal life through Jesus Christ as what? A free gift, the Bible says. How do we get it as a free gift? Because there was a great sacrifice. And the sacrifice was Jesus Christ dying for your sins. Jesus Christ, the Bible says, we were not redeemed by corruptible things such as silver and gold from our vain conversation, received by tradition from our fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without spot and without blemish. Listen, Jesus Christ paid the ultimate sacrifice. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Jesus Christ died for you, my friend. He sacrificed his life on your behalf. You don't have to work your way to heaven. You don't have to do anything to get to heaven. You just have to accept what's been done for you to get to heaven. and you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, He gives you the gift of eternal life, and you shall be saved. What a great salvation. But we enjoy that because there was a sacrifice. The sacrifice was Jesus Christ. And so we're thankful for the sacrifice that goes before there's a success. Listen, doesn't matter what church it is. If you look at any church, you say, boy, that's a great church. I guarantee you there was a sacrifice somewhere along the way. If there's a great marriage, somebody had to sacrifice along the way. Okay? Always sacrifice comes before success. Don't ever forget that. So I see the preparation. That's the first ingredient of vision. Are you willing to prepare? Are you willing to prepare and be willing to be sacrificial? Are you willing to affectionately prepare? I mean, put passion into it. I mean, set your heart on it. And then are you willing to sacrifice for it? Remember when the Jews came back to rebuild the wall under Nehemiah? And Sanballat and Tobiah were the ones who were trying to hinder their work? Anytime you do something for God, somebody's going to be there to discourage you. Somebody's going to be there to try to hinder you. And they were there. You know what they said about the Jews? They said, will they sacrifice? They said, yeah, they'll do the job as long as it's easy. They'll stay with it as long as it's in their comfort zone. But when it really comes down to it, will they be willing to sacrifice? Will they give up anything? And by the way, we read the rest of the story. We know they did. In 52 days, they got the wall built. What did they sacrifice? Sometimes they sacrificed eating. We know that they sacrificed, sometimes they wore their days, their clothes days on end. Took them off, got them washed, put them back on, kept working. They would come, they held a sword in one hand and a trowel in the other. And they got the job done. They sacrificed. It's going to take sacrifice. It's going to take preparation. The second thing I want you to notice about David's vision here in 1 Chronicles 29, notice verse number 6. Then the chief of the fathers and the princes of the tribes of Israel and the captains of thousands and of hundreds and the rulers of the king's work, what did they do, church? Offered willingly and gave for the service of the house of God. And then it says what they gave. So I see, secondly, not just preparation, but I see participation. What happened? Other people got involved. Other people started participating. They willingly participated. Nobody put a gun to their head. Nobody put their arm behind their back. And they willingly participated. Can I say this? The work of God is to be supported by the people of God. Is this on? The work of God is to be supported by the people of God. The church of God is not to be backed just with denominational money. Or the church of God's not to be funded by bake sales, our bazaars, our church suppers. I think it's such a poor testimony to the world when we got to say, now come on out Saturday night and, you know, get your spaghetti. It's only $8 for adults and $5 for children. Because we need your money. Can't pay our bills. What kind of testimony is that to a community? That God's having trouble. We need your help. My friend, no, it's God's work is supported by God's people. But wait a minute. God's work is supported by every one of God's people. Participation. Not spectator sport. It's participation. We take the gospel to every creature. And that's the command, is to get the gospel to every creature. Listen to me, my friend. We take it to the neighbor. We take it to the worker. We take it to the addict. We take it to the prisoner. Take it to the mom and dad. Take it to the children. Take it to the ends of the earth. For that to happen, you got to have participation. Has to have everybody involved. I know people who... There's soliciting for the cancer fund or for the heart fund or the diabetes fund. And I'm not opposed to those things. They're noble causes. They're good causes. But I need to tell you something. I already am zealously, affectionately, sacrificially participating in the Lord's fund. That's where my giving goes. I'm not against the diabetes. But listen, hey, let the people who do not love God and do not support the work of God give to those causes. God's people need to support God's work and God's cause. And that's where my heart is. David said this. You remember when the plague had come on the people and David had asked the Lord to stay the plague, and God ended up staying the plague, and David wants to sacrifice something to God, and he goes to Araunah the Jebusite and has the oxen and the wood that the oxen was in, and David says, I want to buy this from you so I can sacrifice to the Lord. And Araunah said, no. You're not going to buy it from me. If you're going to sacrifice it to God, I'm giving it to you. And David said, you're not giving it to me. How can I call that a sacrifice if it didn't cost me anything? David said, I won't sacrifice unto the Lord my God that which costs me nothing. See, David said, I'm not going to give something to God when it didn't cost me something. Now you think about that. The Bible says this, the tithe is the Lord's. So if the tithe belongs to God and I give God what already belongs to Him, have I given anything yet? No, I've just given God what belongs to Him. So really, if I'm going to start giving, then I have to give what of that which God allows me to keep. Now, God told the people in Malachi, and by the way, don't, that's Old Testament, Pastor. God never told us we had to tithe in the New Testament. You know who says that? People who don't want to tithe. I've never met somebody who said, well, Pastor, I don't want to be limited 10%. I give 40%, and I don't want to go back to that. I've never met somebody like that. But the New Testament, let me ask you this. In the New Testament, is the standard always less than the Old Testament or more than the New Testament? It's always more. Jesus said, you've heard it been said by them of old time, and he'd quote the Old Testament scriptures, and he'd say, but I say unto you, and did Jesus lower the standard or did he raise the standard? He always raised it. Hey, grace should do more than the law. I'm under grace. I know that. And grace ought to do much more than the law. And so I want to go over and above that. Why? Because I shouldn't give to the Lord that which costs me nothing and say I've given. Because I've just given God what belongs to Him anyway. And what is already His in the first place. Now I want you to notice something else here. As He prepares and He has the participation of everybody involved, most of the people who are participating, and certainly in David's case, are participating in a vision that they'll never realize. David gave, got other people to participate, sacrificed, put everything into a building that he'd never see. Wasn't for him. Who's it going to be for? His son and the next generation. That's an amazing thing. Most people, when they give, you know what they want to know? They want to see something in it for them. How am I going to get to enjoy this? But they gave for the future. We're enjoying a buildings here because there are, by and large, there are people. Was anybody in this church in 1970 when this building was built? 1970? That most of you came even after that. So the people who built this building or people who prepared to build this building, they're not enjoying it. We are. I'm sure glad they sacrificed. I'm sure glad they gave so we could have a building. An old man going a lone highway came at evening, cold and gray, to a chasm vast and deep and wide, through which was flowing a swollen tide. That old man crossed in the twilight dim, for the rapids held no fear for him. But he turned when safe on the other side and built a bridge to span the tide. Old man, cried a fellow pilgrim near, you're wasting your time building here. Your journey will end with the closing of day, and you'll never again pass this way. You've crossed the chasm deep and wide. Why don't you build this bridge? Why are you building this bridge at eventide? The builder lifted his old gray head and said, good friend, in the path I have come, there follows after me today a youth whose feet must pass this way. That stream which was has been a knot for me, to that fair youth may a pitfall be. He too must cross in the twilight dim. Good friend, I'm building this bridge for him. That's why we build. That's why we prepare. That's why we participate. It's not just for us. It's for the future. It's for those who come after us. And then I want you to notice the third ingredient, preparation, participation. The third ingredient is in verse number 9. And the Bible says there, then the people, what's the word? Rejoiced. And the third word is praise, just because it's a P, all right? And it matches. But they rejoiced. Why? For they offered willingly. Because with a perfect heart they offered willingly to the Lord. And David the king also rejoiced with great joy. The people rejoiced. King David rejoiced. Everybody rejoiced. The Bible says the desire accomplished is sweet to the soul. It's a great thing when you see the vision come to pass. And the rejoicing that they could have a part, that they could prepare and participate in something that's bigger than they are, in something that's going to live on after they're gone. Think of the joy it is for those who went before us and gave us this building. The joy they have to see the folks still coming and filling it up on a Sunday. It's got to be a blessing to those in the heavenly grandstands. Seeing God do some wonderful things in 11 years at Bible Baptist Church. It's hard to recall everything that has happened in 11 years, but the auditorium has been renovated, of course, and new carpeting, and the downstairs where you come in has been, of course, remodeled. That used to be small little rooms, if you remember, and a junior church room and such, and the nurseries, and all that has been done. New lighting here, new lighting in the fellowship hall, the apartment been renovated upstairs, and now has a restroom and a shower up there. Hallelujah. We lived up there for 6 months when we first came to Bible Baptist Church, and waiting for our house to sell. And we lived upstairs there, and there was no restroom up there then. You had to come downstairs and use the restrooms down in the fellowship hall. And I tell you what, in January, February, that was real fun. See, I'm not going to have you raise your hand, but if you ever get up in the middle of the night to use the restroom, you know, you kind of hope to make it as quick as you can and get back in bed, amen? By the time you get out, go down the steps, go into the bathroom, downstairs, come back out, go all the way up the steps, get back to bed, you're ready to get up, take a shower, and start your day. Thank God for that, amen? I was looking back, our missions giving was around $700 a month when we came, and it's almost $900 a week now. It's amazing what God has done. And that praise goes to Him. All glory goes to God. God's done great things. Hey, we just get to prepare, we get to participate, and then we get to praise the Lord for what God does in us and through us. But somebody has to have the vision. Somebody's got to say, God, don't let me just see what I can see. Let me see what you see. Let me see what you see. Let me do what you want me to do. There's a great promise over in 2 Corinthians. That's in the New Testament. Would you look over there with me? It looks a lot like Chronicles, but it's Corinthians, okay? And it's 2 Corinthians. There's 1 Corinthians, and then go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. There's a great promise here given to us by God. Notice what he says in verse 8. And God, 2 Corinthians 9, verse 8, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. And by the way, what's that about? Verse number 7 is what it's about. Every man is according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And that goes back to verse 6 that says, You sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. You sow bountifully, you'll reap bountifully. So if you sow bountifully, you'll reap bountifully. In fact, what you're going to reap is God is able to make all grace abound toward you. You will have not some sufficiency, not most of it. You'll have all sufficiency in all things. Who can beat that? That's a great promise. That's an amazing statement. I read recently in a survey that said only 3 to 5% of people who give in a church actually tithe. Now, I have no idea. I never look at the giving records. I would like to believe we have a higher percentage than that. But if you're in that group, I would beseech you this morning, I'd beg you this morning to take God at His promise and see if He won't meet your need. Listen to me. I don't care who you are this morning. Your employer or your Social Security or whatever income you're on, that's not your supplier. Your supplier is God. God is the one who takes care of you. God is one. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I'd like to do more, but you know, I'm on a fixed income. God isn't. God isn't. So take it to God. You just say, God, I'm claiming, hey, that widow who gave her 2 mites. Now remember, there were other more rich guys that gave much more than she did. But what did Jesus say? She gave more than all of them. Because Jesus, He wasn't just looking at what was put in. He was looking at what was left over after what was put in. And He admired her faith. I want to ask you a question. Do you think God took care of that widow? You better believe it. I'll guarantee it on the basis of this promise from 2 Corinthians chapter 9. If there is no vision, the people perish. If there is no vision, the church perishes. If there is no vision, the family perishes. If there is no vision, the person perishes. Bible Baptist Church, we're 61 years old. And I haven't been here all 61 years. Listen, let's not lose the vision. Let's not lose the vision. Let's keep the vision. Let's keep the vision. Let's keep having the big days. Let's keep having the turkey dinner Sundays and the country fair days. Let me ask you a question. How many of you here started coming or you were reached because of a big day? Let me see your hand. Put them up in the air. Look at that. Yeah, almost a dozen people. Hey, let's keep the vision. Let's not ever get so low we just say, Lord, bless us for no more. Let's not get that and lose our vision. We're benefiting today because other people kept the vision. Prepare, participate, and we'll praise God together. Let me close with this. I read this week of a pastor who was in Denver for a conference he was in. And he said he was sitting in the lobby waiting for the shuttle to take him to the airport to go back home. And he said a couple came into the lobby. And I noticed the man had a long cane that he was using to find his way around the lobby, and she was at his side to give him assistance. So they made their way over to the couch where he was sitting, and they sat down beside him. I introduced myself and asked where they were from, and they said they were from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Their names were Eunice and Gerald Frederick. He said, I found out they had been in Denver at a conference on how to reach the blind for Christ. Eunice had a Bible in her hand, and to ask if they were headed back home, and she said yes, and she said, but my nephew's coming to pick me up. He pastors a church here, and we're going to attend his church. At one point in the conversation, the preacher here said, I asked Gerald, how long you've been blind? Eunice said, well, my husband was born blind, and I'm legally blind, but the Lord's been good to us. God has His purpose for everything. And we know that we're experiencing all of this so that we can share the gospel with others who are blind. Gerald then leaned over, looked in my direction, and said, "I was born blind, but I believe that I can see better than a lot of folks who have their sight." The Bible says the things that are seen are temporal, but the things that are unseen are eternal. God has allowed me to see things that eyes can't begin to see. The pastor went on to write, Gerald's words jumped out at me and grabbed me by the throat. Here's a 70-plus-year-old man who would have every excuse just to sit back and wait for life to pass him by. But God's given him a vision to reach those who lack sight for the kingdom of God. What a rebuke to you and me. Let's get our vision. Let's have a vision. Let's be willing to prepare, to participate, and to praise God for the opportunity. Hey, it's never too late to have a vision. Don't let life pass you by. Don't just go through and another week goes by, another month goes by, another year goes by. No, don't live that way. Say, God, as the Apostle Paul said, what wilt thou have me to do? And then be prepared. Be prepared. Because he'll show you. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank you, Lord, for everyone's attention today. Thank you, Lord, for your word that's so plain and so clear. Thank you for David. Thank you for his vision that we saw here in 1 Chronicles 29. Lord, what a magnificent house was built for you. He's right, the work was exceeding great. And Solomon's temple was a wonder to many. You build it for the glory of God. Give us a vision of what you would do in us and through us here at Bible Baptist Church. I'm grateful and thankful for what we have seen you do in these 11 years. But Lord, if you tarry your coming, we want to see even greater things in the next 11 years. So Lord, give us that vision to see things as you see them, to be willing to get out of our comfort zones and trust God to do great and mighty things which we know not. Lord, my prayer this morning is twofold. If there's any in the room today that has never realized the sacrifice of Jesus Christ for them on the cross and trusted him as their Savior, I pray they would trust Him as their Savior today. And Lord, those who are in the room today that would say, Pastor, I want to have vision. I want to have God do something great in me and through me. And I want Him to show me His vision. Lord, help us to be men and women with a vision and use us in a great way. Please. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, and I'll finish praying in just a minute. But right now, just between you and God, first I want to know how many folks in the room this morning would say, Pastor, I have realized in my life that Jesus paid the sacrifice for me, that He died in my place and was my substitute, and that I needed to put my faith and trust in Him as my Savior. And there's a time in my life when I did that, Pastor. I prayed, asked Christ to be my Savior, and I know I'm going to heaven when I die. Would you put your hand up for a moment and say, Pastor, I know that I'm saved. You can say it as a testimony. God bless you. You may put it down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I don't know that for sure. I don't know if I died, I'd go to heaven. Could I pray for you? I'll not embarrass you or come to you or call you out, but I'll certainly pray for you this morning. You couldn't raise your hand the first time, but you'll raise it this time. Would you just say, Pastor, pray for me today? I'm not sure that I'm saved. Is there someone like that? And say, Pastor, pray for me. Thank you. Wonder how many Christians here today, and the message was to believers. wonder how many believers today would say, "Preacher, the Spirit of God certainly dealt with my heart this morning. I want to have vision. I want to have the vision for what God wants me to do with my life. And I'm willing to prepare and participate and praise God for what He's going to do." Pastor, pray for me this morning that God show me His vision for my life. Here's my hand. Would you slip it up, Christian, and say, "Pray for me this morning"? Amen. Amen. That's good. Praise the Lord. You may put it down. In a moment, I'm going to pray, and then we'll have our invitation. If God has spoken to your heart this morning, the altar is going to be open for you to come and to pray. Ask God to speak to you, and He's spoken to you. Now you respond to Him this morning. If you're here today and you've never received Christ as your Savior, then when I'm done praying, the pianist will play, Brother Bob will sing. Others are coming to pray. Just slip from your seat and come down to the front. I'll meet you. We have people who've been trained. They'll take a Bible and they'll take you off and to a room and they'll show you from the Bible how you can know Jesus is your Savior. Whatever it is that God has spoken to your heart about, I want you to obey Him this morning. Listen to Him and do what He tells you to do. Father, bless this invitation. Thank you for speaking to hearts this morning. I pray that your will be done now in this invitation, that each one of us will do what you're bidding us to do in our heart. Lord, please, may no one resist you today. Those who need salvation, may they come. Those who just need to bow the knee and say, "God, I'm willing to fulfill your vision for my life. Give me that vision. Give me something beyond sight. Give me vision." So have your way in every life. I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, the pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart this morning. Respond to Him today. Will you please?
Search me, O God.
That's right.
And know my heart.
That's right.
Today. Try me, O Savior. Know my thoughts, I pray. See if there be some wicked way in me. Cleanse me from every sin and set me free. I praise the Lord for cleansing me from sin. Fulfill thy word and make me pure within. Fill me with fire where once I burned with shame. Grant my desire to magnify thy name. Lord, take my life and make it wholly thine. Fill my poor heart with thy great love divine. Take all my will, my passion, self, and pride. I now surrender, Lord, in me abide. O Holy Ghost, revival comes from Thee. Send a revival, start the work in me. Thy word declares Thou wilt supply our need. For blessing now, O Lord, I humbly plead.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you now for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for decisions that have been made for thee today. Thank you for speaking to our hearts this morning. Thank you for each one that's made their way to church today. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. And Lord, I pray that we'll leave this place now to not be just hearers of the word, but to be doers of the word. And so we leave today ready to prepare, ready to participate, ready to praise you for what you'll do in us and through us as we head out into the world. Lord, make us mindful you go with us. Make us mindful that your presence is always there. And I pray that we'll please you in all we do. Give us a good Sunday afternoon and bring us back this evening for our evening service. And I pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Brother Bob.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.